We're so glad you decided to join us today. God wants to do so many things for you and through you, and we want to hear about it. So please share your story at mystory@expchurch.org. And if you want to contribute financially to our ministry, all you have to do is go to expchurch.org/give, and then select the giving option that works best for you. I hope you enjoy this message.
Good morning. There we are. You glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? It is getting closer to Christmas time. We hope everybody's had a great Thanksgiving. I know I did. I had pizza for Thanksgiving. Yeah, I drove 7 hours to have pizza. No, it was wonderful. It was wonderful. My family was tired of turkey because they'd had it 4 or 5 times, and I was so excited, and they were like, let's have pizza. And I'm like, okay. But it was worth it. It was wonderful. I want to tell you about a few things, though, before we get started into worship this morning. First off, we're glad that you're here. We're so thankful that you're here today to worship with us. If you're new, I want you guys to feel welcome. Tell you about a couple things before we get started. If you have a little one, preschool age, we usually dismiss them directly after worship. And then if you have a kid that is about kindergarten to sixth grade, we have Children's Church available and ready right now if they would like to go ahead and go to this entrance right here. And directly across the hall with Pastor Pat is Children's Church. So we want to make sure, and also a couple housekeeping things if you've never been here before. Ladies' restrooms, if you go out of this eve here and turn directly to your left, that's the ladies' room. If you go out this one to the right, directly on your right there is our men's restroom. I'll tell you about a few announcements before we get started. Next Sunday, December the 3rd, is our Youth First Sunday gathering. It's 6 p.m. right here. They have a service every month, and it is powerful. It's incredible about what God is doing in our youth. So 6 p.m. next Sunday here in the main sanctuary. Also, December the 9th at 5 p.m. is our ladies' gathering. That's going to be at Miss Glenna and Pat Michael's home. They have a beautiful home in Lavalette. If you do not know how to get there and you'd love to be a part, just come find one of us ladies. We'll be glad to give you the information to get there. And we'd love to have you come because we have a wonderful ladies ministry that we're thankful for all of our ladies. And then finally, we have baby dedications December the 10th. We love to dedicate babies, and we do it a little bit different. So if you've never been a part of one of our baby dedication ceremonies, I want to encourage you to be a part of it because it is an amazing time. That's December the 10th. If you have a child that you would like to see be dedicated, I encourage you to see Miss Pam or Pastor Ronnie. He is not with us this morning because I know they are with their children this morning at a sporting event. I know those boys are playing in a tournament, doing a great job. We're all about our kids excelling in every area of life. Amen? Amen. Let's go into worship.
Good morning. If you would stand to your feet this morning. Just want to encourage us with a psalm. The Bible says in Psalm 145 that I will exalt you, my God, the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you to extol your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. Do you believe that our God is great this morning? Come on, if you do, I just want you to take a deep breath. And if you can breathe that, you're still listening to me. And that means we're to praise the Lord. The Bible says, let everything that has breath praise Him.
Breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory. is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Oh, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
To rise and fall, begin to lie.
Come on, somebody, lift your voice and give God praise this morning. There's nothing that His love won't do, and there's nothing that, it's not a mountain that faith can't move.
You came,
Yeah, you came. I knew you would come. Oh, I knew that you would come. But you are, you are a miracle working God. You are miracle working God. You are a 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 miracle working God.
Situation in your mind right now. Yeah. Yeah. I see your hands. For just a moment, just in this place right now, I'm hearing the Lord. You could just bow your heads just for one moment. And those of you who lifted your hands, can you just lift your hands high today? Yeah. You need God to intervene in an impossible circumstance in your life right now. You know, Lazarus was dead for 4 days. But it was for the glory of God. The delay is for the glory. Even though the delay causes so much frustration, the delay is for His glory. So, Father, you see these hands in this place today. You see these hearts. You see these minds that are just needing you. They need clarity. They need financial answers. They need to know what God is going to do in their lives next, what you're going to do. What you're going to move. They need to know what their next move is. So today, Father, we come to you and we just acknowledge, Father, that we've done all that we can do. It's not in our hands anymore, but it has to be through you. Because, God, we don't want anything that we could accomplish or manipulate or try to do, Father, because we know it will get us back to where we are right now. So, God, grant absolutely the clarity that is needed for these situations. There's somebody in here that's got a career move that you're not sure whether you're supposed to make, or a career change. It's not even a move, but you're supposed to change some things up, and the Lord's saying the blueprint I gave you in your head is exactly what you're supposed to do. And there's some people in here that you've got something that feels like is out of your control that is changing, and you're concerned because you feel like it's in the hands of somebody else that doesn't have your best interest at heart. And the situation that you're in is causing you turmoil. I'm here to tell you the Lord is saying that you've got to trust me because I, even though it may look like it's not for your best interest, I'm using the person on the other side of the decision to make it work for good for you. Father, we acknowledge that today. We acknowledge you today. Above anything, we hallow your name. We bring praises to you. We don't praise our situations. We don't borrow trouble. We praise you. We praise you. There's somebody in here today that it seems like in good intentions, but you're praising your situation. That the situation is getting more attention than even your kids, even your family. The Lord is saying today, if you'll praise me, if you'll praise me, I'll elevate my name, myself above that situation, and you will see the goodness of the Lord in your life. Father, we just praise you. Can you just lift your heart up to Him today? Let's just lift up a heart of gratitude and thankfulness in this place. Oh, we love you, Father. He's a good Father. We praise you.
There is nothing like your presence here.
There is nothing like your glory falling on me. More of you, less of me. I'm satisfied by you. Just one touch from you, oh Lord. Reach within my heart and make it new. Oh, I must have more of you. 'Cause I'm sad. By you alone, just one touch from you, oh Lord, reach within my heart and make it new, Lord. I must have more.
My hands to worship you. I want to say thank you. Oh, thank you for everything, for who you are. You cover me, touch my heart. I want to say thank you. My soul, can I say thank you, Lord, just for loving me? I love this part today. Many times I do forget every need that you have met. Oh, I thank you, Lord. I know you're showing me that you are there when I am down. You're holding me. Your love is so amazing. Oh, it's changed me. Come on, let's lift this up. So here I am with all I have. I raise my hands to worship you. I want to say thank you. Oh, thank you for everything, for everything. For me, you touch my heart. I want to say thank you. Oh, oh, I thank you. Oh, this is my testimony. I could have died in my sin, but you saved me. I didn't have any hope at all. You gave me peace of mind and strength to carry on. Oh, yes, you did. I should have been the one to pay, but instead you took my place. Amazing grace. Oh, it's more than a song. And even though
say thank you.
Oh, thank you
for everything, for who you are. You cover me and touch my heart. I want to say thank you. Church, I just love the tapestry that God weaves. When all these threads come into a room, He weaves a tapestry. It's called the body of Christ, and it's a beautiful thing. And all through our worship, through the prophetic words that Pastor Steph was bringing before, there's been a common thread with what God's been, and that's the Spirit just moving through our worship, moving through the prophetic word that He would speak into lives. And I just want to bring a word of encouragement that I know is going to resonate louder with some people more than others, but it'll resonate nonetheless. I run a small business. I own a small business, and it's very dependent on the season. In different seasons come, different things happen in this business, and that's fine. We can adapt to that. We can change to that. But I have a lot of conversation with people, and I say, what's your favorite season? And without fail, the answer comes back to personal preference or comfort or self-gratitude. It's like with the kids, it's summer. Summer is my favorite season because there's no school. It's awesome. It's amazing. We get to go swimming all day, every day. It's awesome. For others, it's like, well, you can't beat fall. When we have a fall, not go from summer into winter like we did this year, which is... For me personally, it's spring. I just love the concept of new life. And others, you know, they love winter because it means open fireplaces, it means Christmas. But it all comes back to our own preference. One of my favorite songs at the moment is a song called Seasons. And that song that Curtis led us in, that talks about Lazarus in the grave, in the tomb. So many people can relate to that on the level that there was a prophetic word that came, a promise from God that came. And there was so much future tied up in that promise, so much of our dream tied up in that promise. But then that promise goes to the grave. Prematurely. And in this song, in the bridge, it says, I can see the promise, I can see the future. You're the God of seasons, I'm just in the winter. If all I know of harvest is that it's worth my patience, that if you're not done working, God, I'm not done waiting. There's some truth right there. You can see my promise even in the winter because you're the God of greatness even in a manger. For all I know of seasons is that you take your time. Thank you, Lord, for taking your time. Whew. You could have saved us in a second. Instead, you sent a child. You may be in that winter season right now, where that dream appears to have stalled, and it hasn't just stalled, the wheels have fallen off. Everything in it's not moving forward anymore. But I want to speak prophetically into your situation right now, and if this is resonating even just a bit with you, would you raise your hands? Because I just want to continue on with what Pastor Steph was just ministering earlier, that we would call out, that we would call back to life, with not just a sense of self-gratification, God, I need this to happen for me, but God, you're here to be glorified in my life. This is for your glory. This is not for my own glory, but God, this is for your glory. And the reason I want to revisit this in this service right now is because the tapestry that God's weaving through this body of believers is something that brings Him glory. It brings Him great, great joy. Heavenly Father,
We just thank you that you are always true to your word, but you are a God of seasons. And that promise that would appear to be laying dead and dormant, Lord God, Father, the reason it went to the grave is to crucify the flesh off it, the way we wanted it to happen. Father, I pray that the flesh that we put on that promise that came from your throne room, the flesh that we molded around it, the way we wanted it to look, Lord God, would be crucified off that promise. And Lord God, in resurrection power, in your time, in for your glory, God, that you would resurrect that dream, you would resurrect that business idea, you would resurrect that relationship, you would restore, Lord God, that which you have authored, that you would complete it and finish it, mighty God. Father, not in the way we want it to look, but Father, the way you intended, the way it was spoken from your throne room, Lord God. Father, I thank you that you don't always give us all the information. Father, because it's for our benefit. It's for our benefit not to know. It's for our benefit to grow in this season, Lord God. That as a seed would get sown, as a seed would die, Lord God, so much more transforms in that process, Lord God. And Father, I speak to this house. I speak life to dead situations. I speak life into dead relationships. I speak your resurrection power to come upon people's own relationship with you. The way we thought we would relate to our God, our Savior. That there would be a new dimension of your Lordship, Lord God. For some that just know you as a Redeemer. There would be a revelation, Lord God, an awakening. That would just reveal to us a new dimension of who you are and who we are in you. Heavenly Father, I pray that by your Spirit you continue to move. Father, don't let this just be a moment we have in these four walls, but as we go out, Lord, let this word just begin to cultivate, begin to brew in our lives. Let it stew in our minds. Let us marinate in this season, Lord God. That you would peel back and show us another aspect of your glory. Oh, Holy Spirit, just have your way. Thank you, Lord God. Be encouraged, church.
Come on, somebody just celebrate who the Lord is. Thank him for what he's doing in this house. In this place today, can you find two or three people around you? Let them know that you're glad to be in the Lord's house with them this morning. If there's somebody new, love on them. Don't let anybody go without a handshake, hug, or high five. No headlocks.
Well, praise the Lord. Did you have a nice Thanksgiving? I would take that the ones that didn't answer said no. Glad it's over.
That's good, Mark.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, the Lord is good, I tell you. Y'all like the Christmas decorations and the trees? If you get an opportunity, you need to drive through here at night. Some of the trees, or a lot of the trees, are lit up out there on the street. Cheshire Way is what that's called. 115 Cheshire Way is the address. But if you get an opportunity to drive through there at night, you'll see it. We spend a little time decorating those trees. Well, Dale and Chad did, and it looks good. It really does. You'll see it if you get an opportunity to swing by here in the evening time. And as you drive by, say a prayer. Just pray as you drive by that the Lord will bless the whole region here and will not be just another building that gathers with a lot of people. Will be a building that facilitates the presence of the Lord, the identifying of people, what God has placed in their life, to affirm it, to equip them, and release them into what God's called people to be released into. Every one of us have a unique, diversified call on our life. And we believe that the Lord is, if he brought you here, then it's through relationship, from relationship, through relationship, that we all learn and live life together. And we really, truly believe in living life together. And if you're here long enough, I know we've got several new visitors today, new guests, and we want to welcome you and thank you for being here with us. You could have been anywhere else this morning, but you chose to be here. We've got lots and lots of people out, and some are shopping. God bless their soul. Some are on traveling football teams. There's just a lot of people. Some are sick and watching from home. I had several texts this morning. Some just didn't feel like getting out and going. And I'm talking to you and you're watching on the internet. I saw you. We're just glad you're here. We are. We're thankful. The Lord has been faithful to us. He's been good to us. And we know that this is just the beginning. It was, as Brendan was talking about seasons, we've kind of learned here at the church over the course of time that the, you know, there's a rhythm of culture that you have that just, you just can't go against the rhythm of culture. It's just the way it is. I'll give you an example. If you try to do anything special, like initiating a new evangelistic program or ministry between Thanksgiving and New Year's, you're out of your mind. All right, because people just are not in the mood or in the emotional state for those kind of things to happen. So you have to know what the seasons are. And we've identified four seasons here from January to about Memorial Day is a real strong growth season. It's winter. People go through some depression after Christmas. And then it starts getting close to Easter, and they come out. The weather has changed, like Brenda was talking about. The life starts coming back again, and all the way to Memorial Day, kids are out of school. So it's a hard 5 months, if you know what I'm saying. It's just challenging, and it's good to see you guys. That was a pleasant surprise this morning, Jordan and Kayla Pratt from Nashville, and it's good to have them back with us today. But then you have that's the kind of January through January 1st through Memorial Day. Memorial Day through Labor Day is kind of summer, and people get vacations. We encourage you to get away, get some break with your family. You need to rest during the summer. You have to. You just have to. So then come Labor Day is another push because kids get back to school around that time or thereabouts. College is in. College football's already started or starting, and things go pretty quickly, so it's back to routine of life again. And then it goes all the way to about Thanksgiving. And at Thanksgiving to Christmas or New Year's is more of a festive family type atmosphere that you're in. Lots of parties, lots of gatherings, lots of get-togethers. But I also recognize that, you know, during this time of year, Thanksgiving and Christmas, some of you are sitting there saying, man, this is going to be the best holiday season I've ever had. Others of you are going to say, gosh, I don't know that I can get through this one. I'm feeling pressure. I'm feeling, you know, a depression trying to hit me. Perhaps you've lost a loved one. I know a lady, talked to her really late last night, and she had lost her husband in February, and this is the first holiday season without him, and they've been married a long time. So she's having to adjust, and, you like to find words to comfort, but the reality of it is comfort is just your friendship. And being there for somebody, but you can't take away that hurt that they're feeling. It's just a process people have to go through. So maybe you're in one of those positions. We just want to encourage you that you don't have to be alone. And what you're feeling, whether it be up, down, in between, happy, joyful, or even mad, angry, and lots of questions, it's okay to feel all that. Is that okay? It's okay to feel that. It is. I know people will tell you that you need to change your feelings when you're going through, you know, this is a time, holidays are joyful for a lot of people, but they're not joyful for everybody. So those of you that are joyful, you need to find somebody Amen. That you know that is not. And then you don't need to go preach them a sermon, write them a 3-page note and call it the Third Corinthians. You don't need to do that either. You just need to maybe reach out and let them know that you love them, you care, and make yourself available. But you don't need to push yourself on them. Just make yourself available. Good?
That's
Because some people want to be alone. Some people want to have company. And don't think that's the way you would feel is how everybody feels. Is that okay? Yes. Don't impose your convictions on other people. Invite people to, you know, we went through the whole, I want to make sure everybody here, nobody was eating Thanksgiving alone. So I went on the phone tree. I started calling people. Okay, texting. Hey, what do you got? Where are you at? What are you doing? And finally, I got the last one. He said, hey, leave me alone. And I said, you got it. You got it. So I texted him about an hour later, and I said, you still alone? They said, yeah. I said, well, good. I said, as long as you're alone, you're okay. Now watch the football game. Turn it on. And so we kind of joked about it. But we want to make sure that we are a family. And you'll see, if you are here long enough, you'll see that we connect. And we work real hard at connecting. And nobody has to walk through some things alone. In fact, I was going to preach out of Joshua chapter 10 and right on that last song, last two songs actually, the Lord just dropped a story in the Bible to me. And I'm going to go there in just a minute. And I don't even know where it is. I'm going to have to find it. It's in the New Testament. It's in the Gospels. But I'm not sure exactly what passage of Scripture is. Seth, it's the withered hand. And whichever one you want to pull up will work. We'll do that in just a few moments. But I'm going to receive a tithe and offering now, if you don't mind. And if you do mind, I'm going to do it anyway. Okay? It takes finances to run an organization and costs money for light bills and all of that. But I want you to do something today, not to give out of, because there's a need. I want you to give out of the goodness and of the faithfulness that the Lord has been to you. And we don't give just so you can get, even though he always gives you back. You give because he has given to you. And, you know, one of the things that we're learning here as a church is you get a big vision. Big vision requires square footage, and it requires finances, and it requires people. But you got to make sure that, Aaron, are you still needing a car? I know when the Lord starts doing this kind of stuff, it just bothers me because I've already had something in my head that I prepared for 3 days on how I was going to go, and then 5 minutes ago, he starts changing all this, so I kind of know how I see what's happening here. So we're just going to mind the Lord, if it's okay with you guys, for a few moments. I just feel the Lord wants to do some kingdom business. Aaron, won't you stand up for just a second, if you don't mind? I'm not embarrassing you or putting you on the spot, but I'm going to embarrass you and put you on the spot. Aaron has been with us from the very beginning, and Aaron is needing a vehicle, a decent vehicle. Not one that he has to put a lot of money in to make it run. What did he say? Right. So if anybody has a vehicle they want to not sell him but give him, and it runs, it's dependable. How many kids do you have? Three. So it's got to be bigger than a two-seater. Okay? Just see me or Aaron after church, if that's okay. And I believe the Lord just spoke to me and told me somebody's in here that has one. Okay? Okay? Okay. Today will be your day. You have one? There you go. Today your first service here? Welcome. You just can't make it up, can you? We're going to receive an offering. Why don't you all sit down for just the offering? We're just going to, let's just do this. Let's just see what the Lord's doing here. Let's just wait on him for just a second. You guys mind? Let's just pray. Amen. Father, you're intertwined deeply, affectionately in the lives of every single person that's here. You're in the details, the crevices, under the rock. There are people here this morning, God, that have worry, they have fear, they have anxiety and depression, they have unanswered questions. Some don't even have the questions to even ask, they just are numb. But God, this is not a time for you to be silent in their lives. You know how they communicate. You know how they hear. You know what they're wanting to say, but don't know how to say it. You know they're inquiring of you, so you can't make it complicated or over their head. So right now, Lord, for just a moment, our hearts and ears are turned toward you, waiting on a specific, detailed knowing, a voice, an utterance, a nudge, a wink, a nod. There's people in here today, God, that need an assurance that they're headed in the right direction. They need an answer for their desperation. And they have faith. They believe you. They trust you. But they don't know what to do. And right now, Lord, it's not a time for rhetorical communication. We need direct and responsive communication from you. We need phones to ring, texts to go off, emails to come, visits to show up, mail to be received. I heard the Lord say that somebody in here has been thinking this thought over and over again, and it's even come to you this morning. If you had not have, if I had not have, if I had not have, if I only would have not have, And the Lord is saying, don't say that anymore. You cannot live a life of regret. The snapshot of your moment in life right this moment is an opportunity for the Lord to get the glory he deserves. And you're asking the question, what do I do? Do I go? Do I stay? Do I run? Do I change? Do I go a different direction? How much do I put my hands on it, and how much do I take my hands off of it? And the Lord says, as the seasons have changed, even in the atmosphere and the environment, the seasons have changed for you. What you've tolerated and tried to manage and self-manage has only stole years off of your life. When you thought it was going to get better, it had a twinge of improvement, but only to go back to the way it was, or maybe even worse. But the only thing that's happened is time has gone on and on. He said, but this season is different. This season comes with boldness and courage. You have to stand your ground. You have to be firm. You have to be intolerant of things that cause your life dis-ease. The question you ask yourself is, gosh, if I'm intolerant of the things that cause my life disease, will I lose the very thing I'm really wanting to see change? And the Lord says, no. You'll become healthier, and so will the people around you. Don't hold on with strings attached. Let it go, assuming that it may not ever come back to you. Don't move off your convictions, and don't compromise of your convictions. You've settled for way too long. Some have even prayed the prayer, God, if you'll get me out of this mess, I'll never do that again. And now you find yourself in a similar mess. And you said, man, I deserve this, because I remember making that promise to God. God said, quit reminding me of something that you broke. He's living in the now. He's not living back then. He said, some of you have lost your oomph, lost your fervor, your fire, your passion. Because life circumstances have kind of distracted you and taken you away. He said, dust off some things that you put on the shelf. Get them off the shelf, because you're going to need them in this season.
very end, and then with open arms, I will ask you to come home. Amen.
This is in the twinkling of an eye. Things are going to change. You've begged, you've pushed, you've argued, you've fought, and things didn't change. But you're going to begin to see things change because I'm changing them. I'm turning the hearts right side up instead of upside down. Their desires are going to be different. The desires are going to be for righteousness. The desires are going to be for holiness, purity, right standing, love, compassion, generosity. You're going to see selfish people have such a heart change that they're going to be about other people rather than themselves. You're going to see people that were so full of pride and self-reliance, not bad people, but good people. You're going to see them as they go through situations and circumstances. They're going to be full of compassion. And rather than be judgmental or critical of other people that are going through stuff, they'll be full of compassion. The body's maturing. It's growing up. It has to mature because I have to have a place to put my authority or lay my head. Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head or rest his head. He needs a body that's mobile, active, healthy, energetic, purpose-filled, driven, distinct, undeniable, faith-filled. You look around and you see the condition of the communities and look at the condition of this country. Nobody can label it right now because it's in such disarray. But I'm shaking it up like it's never been shaken up before. But the solution to establish it is coming through the body. I've called you to be a part of the establishment, to establish the righteousness of the kingdom that'll be sustained throughout generations. You're afraid to fail. You're afraid to step out. You're afraid to risk it all. Because you've tasted the smell and the taste of the failure in the past. You don't want to repeat that again. But the failure that I'm talking about, the Lord says, is stepping out into a place where he's comfortable and you're not. He enjoys our comfort. He wants us now to come out and enjoy his comfort. That means you live outside of yourself and you live for others more than you live for yourself. You lay your life down and you deny yourself for the sake of a brother or a sister. You go the extra mile when somebody needs something. He said, your past, you've let them stay open wounds. He said, I meant for them to become scars. Scars are for testimonies. Open wounds still have hurt, pain. Let your past relationship, the failure of that relationship, go. Nail it to the cross and walk away. Quit worrying about what everybody thinks about you. God will put the people around you that love you, that think highly of you, but only be concerned about what he thinks about you. And he's pleased. But you don't know what I've done. Yeah, he does. He still loves you. There's an economic shift that's taken place in this country. The Lord says, I have got to get you prepared to be able to handle a lot more resources than you've ever handled in the past. I can't have you thinking small. Your previous frame of reference is too small. You have to think bigger. If I gave you a 10-acre farm and you farmed it, I'll give you 20. If you had a portfolio of 100 million, I'll give you a portfolio of 2. If I give you 5 friends, I'll give you 10. I'll give you 1 song, I'll give you 2. If I healed your headache, I'll heal your body. If your upset stomach went away, your eyesight will improve. I know they told you that the body is decaying and getting older, and you've kind of lived with the fact that you're aging. And you're just expecting some things just to be that way. He said, let me remind you that they lived 900 years, 800 years, 300 years in the old covenant. And you have Christ. Not one feeble body came out of Egypt. Not one sick person came out of Egypt. They didn't have the blood of Jesus. You have the blood of Jesus. We've turned the promises of God into maybes, possibilities, and watered down the reality of those are bound by his word. It's all shifting. And the Lord said, I've already put it in motion and there's not a thing you can do about it. You're being purged right now to prepare for increase in your life. You've had hope. You stood on hope. And hope is to bring your future into your now. But you're going to move into faith, real faith, which takes your now into your future. He said, you're worried about your children. I hear you. You're afraid the influences that have been around those children have maybe hurt them and made them be skewed the way they view life and the world. He said, but the seed that I planted in you is the same seed that I planted in them. And your kids will not go astray. I'll block out of their memory every bad image that the enemy has tried to place in their image, in their mind. I'll block it. They'll remember it no more. There's a woman in here that you're trying to do the right thing. Trying to raise your kids, involved in their activities. You pray, you seek God, but he doesn't budge. He provides, he does the best he can based on what he knows. The Lord says you probably should go ahead and prepare yourself, because as he makes a radical transformation, he's going to become the leader of that home spiritually. And you're going to need to learn how to follow and allow him to lead spiritually. Your prayers are going to get answered. Prepare your heart to live in the reality of what you're praying for. He said, There's somebody in here that just recently was terminated from their job. When you're worried, it's affected your ego. It's affected your ability to provide. And your biggest fear is you're going to lose everything else around you because you lost your job. The Lord says, I know how to sustain you while you're going through this process. But I want to teach you how to trust me, because I'm the one that provides for you. I give to you. I set them up and I set them down. He says, you don't even have to ask me for what I have for you. Every request that you've had of me since you've lost your job has been so limiting. I desire to give you more than what you've even asked for. Some of you in here, you're afraid of dying. Parents, your grandparents, now you have passed away from a condition, and now you are experiencing some of those symptoms. You've been thinking an awful lot about it. And you're just thinking, well, it just comes in the bloodline. The Lord says, quit thinking about that. So fear sets in when you think about that. Think about my bloodline. Somebody in here has really relied on their security, and you've stayed in what you thought was a secure place for a long time. And the Lord says, pull up those roots. It was a false sense of security. He said, I'm going to show you what security is. Since some of you in here in the last month have gone through your closets at home and you've seen your clothes and you look at your clothes and you say, my gosh, I've got things I just need to really give away or I just need to, and he said that should jog a memory right now because what I'm really telling you, he said, was I'm ready to change everything about you. He said, go ahead and clean out the closet. He said, tell the people that they can't keep spiritualizing everything. Some things just need to be done. Tell them they don't need a lightning bolt from heaven to do the right thing. Just do the right thing. He said 2018 is not going to be like a year like you've ever experienced. He's going to give you the passion and the drive, the desire, and opportunity in 2018. That'll be a culmination in 1 year of what you've experienced in your 10 best years. And you'll see it as soon as the year begins. There's been decades of prayers that have gone to heaven, and the vials are full. The prayers of your aunts and your uncles and your moms and your dads and your grandparents, neighbors, Sunday school teachers, preachers and pastors and fathers and mothers, children. You're not going to escape the blessing of the Lord. You're not going to be able to run from it. He's going to chase you down with his goodness, even if you don't deserve it. Oh, here's a word. The enemy of the blessing of the Lord for 2018 and for your life in this season, the enemy is procrastination. If you procrastinate, you will get out of sync with the blessing of the Lord. But he desires to be in sync with you. So whatever he tells you to do, do it.
I am your light. I shine bright. I want you to just step close to me. Open up your hearts and don't wait
directors. I am the light of life. I am the glory of glory. I shine through all. You cannot hide from me. I seek you, child, and I want you. Be present in my life and come my way. The way is light. The road is light. My yoke is light.
With every head bowed and eye closed. Nobody's looking around right now. As the word just came forward, there's somebody in here, and there may be multiple people that need to take on and put on the goodness of God and receive his goodness, receive his forgiveness, receive his love, his compassion, his tenderness. And you need to exchange it for your ways that you had in the past. And if I'm talking to somebody out here and it's you, would you just raise your hand with nobody looking? I see your hands. Those of you that raise your hands, I want you just to get up out of your seat. I want you to come up front. I hope somebody, have someone pray with you. If you raise your hand, I want you just to come up here. Nobody's being embarrassed. Thank you. Thank you. I just need a couple of ladies and a guy to come up and pray with them. Thank you all. If everybody could just stay engaged this direction and not leave. We've got about 10 more minutes and I want to finish up, but I want to allow this moment to be what it's really intended for. The Lord is faithful. And the Lord is good. The Lord is merciful. He's kind, he's patient, he's long-suffering, he's meek and tenderly. He's gentlemanly. He's direct, straightforward, purpose-filled. He's jealous over you. He won't share you with the things of this world. He wants you all to himself. He wants to be first, premier, take the highest position of your life. He didn't want you to get in that position so you can get something from him. He wants you to realize you're in that position and accept that position and come up with him, and the blessing of the Lord follows. You can't manipulate him. Can't twist him. Can't hide from him. But you don't have to be afraid of him either. The desires of your heart to see things change in your life are even greater desires in his heart to see change in your life. You're going to see a radical transformation. It begins today. Shake the dust off your feet. embrace a brand new way of life. Tears are going to begin to well up inside of your hearts because he's breaking up a lot of fallow ground. Your hearts have become hardened over time because of unanswered prayer and just grind and living life and trying to make ends meet and try to get ahead, and your hearts have become hardened, not anything you intended to do. You thought this was going to happen and that didn't happen, and over the course of time you just get in a funk or a rut, and the Lord says, today I'm bringing you up out of that rut. He said, if the circumstances of your life are what determines your joy, then the circumstances of your life are your God. He said, get your joy from me, which will give you strength, so you can see your circumstances different than you see them now. I'm good whether your circumstances change or not, he says. I'm faithful whether your circumstances change or not. I'm merciful and kind whether they change or not. But if you get a hold of that I'm merciful and kind and faithful, he says, you'll see your circumstances begin to change. He didn't have to prove himself to you because he already knows who he is. What he wants you to do is see him for who he is and begin to live out of that view of life. He said the body of Christ is going through what Paul went through over 3 days. Paul became blinded to what he knew. So when his eyesight came back, he was able to see a whole different way. And over the course of the last several months or years, the body of Christ has gone through a blinding period. We thought we knew, but we didn't know. But I'm here to declare to you today prophetically that the scales that have been on the body of Christ's eyes are falling off. You're going to see brighter, clearer, further, closer than you've ever seen before. Things that were once tolerable won't be tolerable anymore. Things that you once craved won't even be a craving anymore. The Lord said, tell him it's the best time to be alive. He saved you for this time. You're going to get a witness, the greatest outpouring of the Spirit of God this world has ever seen. I was walking through my living room just a couple of days ago, and as I walked through, I was minding my own business. Really wasn't even thinking about God. I was thinking about sports, to be honest with you. And all of a sudden, the Lord spoke to me and said a little bit of what he repeated in today, but he said this to me. He said, I enjoy coming in where you are and living inside your comfort area. He said, I enjoy that. He said, but I have recreation out here in my comfort area, but you very rarely come out there. You're always inviting me in your situation and your stuff. You're always inviting me in here. Let me invite you in my stuff. He said, my stuff makes you feel uncomfortable, but I have recreation in it. I get joy when you're in your discomfort. He said, don't pray for people anymore when they come inside your area. He said, I need you to come outside in my area and pray for people. He said, you haven't failed enough in my area. He said, you're fairly safe here. You've created the walls of defense. And you're safe inside there. You pretty much know you can control that comfort area. But I'm bringing you outside that comfort area. I'm going to demand you to pray for people outside of your area where your reputation, it might look like it's on the line, but it's really going to be mine. I'm going to cause you to live in an economy that's out here where my comfort area. He said, you're comfortable where you are. I'm going to bring you outside of there. God forbid that we just come together and enjoy the music, which is excellent. Me prepare all week and have a message that stimulates us. But Aaron doesn't get a car. Somebody doesn't get their marriage restored. Somebody doesn't get free from an abusive one. Life's about advancement, progression, increase. It's all part of the kingdom. Ushers, if you're ready, we're going to receive the offering. We're a church that believes in tithing. Barry's not feeling well today. He's got the flu. So I need you to give more normally than you do so I can show him that he doesn't have the market on the offering thing, okay? Tithe and offering. Make checks payable to ECH. Those of you that normal that tithe regularly at the home here, this is your house. You probably already have your checks made out, but others of you that want to text give, you can. It's 84321. How that works is you type that number in from your text message on your phone. If you've never done it before, it'll come back, give you a link. You hit the link, put your bank information in, and from that point on, all you got to do is text your amount that you want to give. Okay? I want you to give out of the goodness of what God has done for your life. Amen. Are you ready to give? Who needs an offering envelope? They're underneath your chairs if you need one. I'm going to tell you this, and this is almost like a hit and run because we're getting ready to close here in just a minute. But some of you have not tithed and not got into tithing. It's not been a part of your regular lifestyle of worship. And you've done offerings. And the Lord has been wrestling with you, some of you, on this. And some of you may not even know anything about it, but some of you do. And there was a time in your life that was just a pillar, a foundational principle. And life took you a different direction. And the Lord's not correcting you. He's just giving you instruction to say, here's an adjustment. It's not about giving money to the church. It's about giving to Him. Right? And He creates and lets you live in an economy that He lives in. He wants you to bring you into that place. Are you ready to give? Father, in Jesus' name, we bless you with our tithe and our offering. Amen. Amen. Okay. I want to mention to you a couple of things too while they're receiving the offering. Ken Snyder, do you all remember Ken? We're doing a Ken and Nancy. Ken was a part of us from the very first service, actually pre-service. And Ken was part of a worship team. And Ken and Nancy had moved to Tip City, Ohio to work in ministry up there at a church. I guess it's probably been 6 months, a year ago now. And Ken passed away unexpectedly just a few weeks ago. So next Saturday, this coming Saturday, the 2nd at 2 o'clock, about 2 to about 3 o'clock, we're going to have a memorial service right here for Ken and Nancy. So in lieu of flowers, Nancy is going to go through probate. It's going to take months to go through all of that. So in lieu of flowers, she just asked that monetary donations be given to her or the family to help support some of these expenses that they have. That's next Saturday at 2 o'clock. I want to invite you also, too, that this year's Christmas Eve service, Christmas Eve falls on a Sunday, and
Sunday morning at 11 o'clock, we'll have a regular service, but it's not going to be a regular service. It's going to be a Christmas Eve service. How many of you watched or able to watch last year on Christmas Day, Family Expression Family Christmas? Did you all see that on Channel 3, WSAZ? This year, we're going to do a semi-portion of that live right here on that Sunday morning, okay? So we want to invite you all to come and be a part of that. We'll have some things, some desserts and things after service for the kids and cookies and all kinds of stuff, whatever they're planning on doing. But it'll be a good time in the Lord that Christmas Eve. Also, the following week, which will be New Year's Eve, we'll have our Sunday morning service. But I'm going to launch this into 2018. And I've got a real specific thing the Lord has been given to me this past week, specifically about what we're going to expect in the next launch of the 2018 year. We've got some incredible ministries that are going to be launched up. Celebrate Recovery is going to be launching next in January here at the church. There's a lot of things that are in motion, and we'll share a lot of that with you on New Year's Eve. So a lot of new ministries that will be birthing, a lot of new ministries, women's, men's, all kinds of things are going to be happening. So I just want to encourage you to connect, to be a part. We're going to have some fresh expression class, some membership stuff that comes to be a part of what the Lord is doing here. If you would you stand with me? I know they've received the offering. Is there anything else I'm missing? Well, so much for Joshua and so much for the withered hand. How many of you felt like you were in the presence of the Lord today? Good. It was unconventional, I guess. But the most important thing is the Lord gets glory and people get direction. When you come into the face-to-face encounter with God and you hear a word from the Lord, I've had so many words in my life go, and I walk away going, what am I going to do with that? You know, I need it to be practical. The Lord, the Bible says that the Word, Jesus, the Word, became flesh and dwelt amongst men, tabernacled with men. In other words, He came down and you relate to it. So it's got to be practical and relatable, okay? So I'm believing the Lord as you walk out of here today that even though we've never had a service like this before, that you'll never have a day like you've had today, and your life will be transformed and changed, and the impact and imprint that you receive today and direction, even though you may not even know what it looks like, you'll walk into it as you walk out of here. Are you ready? Father, in Jesus' name, I bless the people that are here this morning and watching by internet. I bless them. Lord, they're hungry for more of you. They're here today because they're inquiring of you. They have a relationship with you, or they're seeking a relationship with you. Now, God, don't make this difficult. As sure as Joshua spoke to the sun and the sun stayed in its place for 24 hours, the book says that you heard the voice of the man and you did what he said. I'm asking you, in the name of our Lord and Savior, in the name of our Christ, in the name of the crucified one, the resurrected one, the Son of the living God, I'm asking you to pour out your Spirit in the heart and minds and lives of these people. And when they walk in it every day of their life and they see the goodness, they see your mercy, they see your grace, they see your love, your kindness, and Lord, they'll be overwhelmed and overcome and overshadowed by the power of your love. We bless them as they walk out of here today and have them have one of the best weeks they've ever had in the entire life, a relationship and fellowship walking with you. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. God bless you all.